How exciting. How exciting. Hello, everybody. Welcome
Very exciting.
To Torn Tuesday, your weekly dose of all things Hobbit and Lord of the Rings
and fantasy.
Tolkien.
And fantasy.
Well, today. But today is a huge freaking day. If you're not watching us right now live, then you're probably at the cinema
in
right
the theater,
now
yes.
watching the extended edition Battle of Five Armies. It's in cinemas tonight, and we're gonna. It's 5 o'clock here in the middle of Hollywood. We're at Meltdown Comics, center of all things geek, and it starts at 7:30. So we've got
local
we've got
time.
About 2 hours
before
until
we get out of here and run to the theater.
And
yes.
run to the theater,
yes,
because I can't wait to see the version of Battle of Five Armies that
we've been waiting for.
That we were supposed to get in the first place.
That's right. That's right. Well, wasn't it really the shortest running time of all Middle-earth films of all six?
And it should have been longer.
It was the shortest running time.
They.
And he added, what, 20 minutes? Mr. Peter Jackson has added 20 minutes to the extended edition. And that, hopefully, will put back some of the very important story threads and conclude, like, concluding pieces of narrative that finish some of the stories of all these extra characters properly. We really, really are looking forward to this, aren't you?
I am. And wave to all our friends in the chat room. Waves to Spirited Books. EVA24 is up at 2 a.m. here in Denmark to watch the show. I can't wait to see this movie. I mean, there was stuff in the trailers. Look.
That's great, Ava.
Warner
Thanks
Brothers
for staying up so late. That's fantastic.
Just sent over today. Warner Brothers sent over the screen grab. How they made a screen grab, I don't know, but they made this screen grab from the battle where it looks like...
Let me see that. Really? Look at that.
It looks like a silver fox of a dwarf.
Well, that's Balin.
And with a blonde haired... Is that a Feely?
Yeah.
Or is that an elf?
No, that's... Well, that's Feely.
Is it?
Yeah, that's Feely. He's blonde.
I don't know.
Mostly.
Because I think...
Well,
Billy
this is the missing chariot moment that was in the trailer. We were looking for it in the film. It never made it into a theatrical release. But
yes.
There it is.
And then we got this other photo. Looks like a beast of burden. A troll has been turned into a beast of burden. He's got a... that's not a catapult. That's one of those other things where they fling rocks on top of it. But they're
Indeed.
Pretty darn close to, if you look at that, they're pretty darn close to the gates of Erebor. So those trolls get pretty far, and he's got a big thing on his back. Erevandi.
That's like a trebuchet attached to his back.
Oh, we got jokes in the chat room saying video game music. Yes, the extended CG edition is basically what everybody's going to go watch tonight. So
yes,
I can't wait to see this. And then if you're not able to go see it in theaters because it's only a U.S. release, which makes no sense, it will be out on iTunes next week. You'll be able to digitally download the high definition version, supposedly with all the features of the extended edition next week.
That includes all of Michael Pellerin's great appendices, which would be appendices, well, the last two, 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10, what 11 and 12? Wouldn't it be appendices 11 and 12?
I think so.
Yeah. Part 11 and part 12. The very last big chunks of behind the scenes special items that Michael Pellerin had so craftily made for us.
So next week it's available online, and then 3 weeks after that you'll be able to pick up your
yes.
Blu-ray and
your Blu-ray.
DVD versions, and you finally get a trilogy. You can pick up the Hobbit trilogy box set, which I know a lot of people have been waiting for the trilogy. You know, just buy it once and get the box and everything like that. So
to complete
really,
your set of your other boxes,
it's really
yes.
cool to see Warner Brothers marketing this film the day of the release. You'd think that we would have maybe got these screen grabs a week ago or even 2 days ago.
You'd think. But hey.
Hey, but we can do a whole show about the marketing of The Hobbit and how it was different.
Oh,
Lord
we
of the Rings.
We could do a very close examination of how all fantasy films are marketed. how they're marketed overseas, how they are here in North America and Canada. Certainly there's a big difference in how things are marketed in Japan, as we know. But wouldn't that be interesting to see, to go, you know, peel back that little curtain where we're not supposed to pay attention to that little man behind the curtain, to see what kind of marketing to and fro. I would love to be a fly on the wall in those studio conversations.
Well, can 19 minutes really fix this movie?
Well, Anonymous 5297, can 19 or 20 minutes really fix the movie? That is a loaded statement, which, I guess, presupposes that it needs to be fixed. Well, the best thing you can do to fix the Battle of the Five Armies is to watch it all at the same time with Unexpected Journey and Desolation of Smaug. I think that the movies for The Hobbit are so much better together of a piece than they are separated by 12 months at a time.
The problem
That's a big, big thing that made them feel that way.
From what I've heard, again, we haven't seen it yet. The extended edition is tonight. But from what we've heard, the extended edition scenes include more CG Legolas, more Legolas flying on a bat, more of the Master of Lake Town's assistant and his brutal death. Alfred's death.
Alfred actually gets
a
death.
And
really? Okay.
We get double the amount of footage of Beorn. So we go from 1.3 seconds to 2.6 seconds of Beorn rampaging. So it's everything
what?
You want.
2.6 seconds?
It's everything you wanted out of the extended edition. You got double the Beorn, you get more CG Legolas, and you get Alfred untimely demise. So I guess that's what everybody wants in this movie, and I can't wait to see it on the big screen tonight. Can't you?
I'm very excited as well, but I think your math might be a bit askew, because Beorn had 9 seconds. We counted.
9 seconds, sorry.
In the theatrical version, Beorn had 9 seconds. So now he has 18 seconds?
Yep, he has a full 18 seconds worth of screen time.
According to rumor.
Which means that he still doesn't have enough to make a 30-second TV commercial.
Do you know what? Let's just say, caveat emptor, that's a rumor. We don't know for sure.
We'll find out tonight.
Yeah, we are.
Some fans are finding
out. We are
going to
find out.
Right now. As we speak, you know, other news this weekend or this week, what a huge, huge, huge release. This is probably the biggest release that a Tolkien fan could ask for, and I'm surprised the fandom is not just falling all over themselves. The Art of Middle-earth, J.R.R. Tolkien's new book, published this week. We have a preview copy. We're trying to get some more copies to give away. If you go to our Twitter and Facebook, I think we do have one or two copies to give away of The Art of Middle-earth, The Art of Tolkien. This isn't just work done by Ted Naismith and John Howe. No, the bulk of this book is Tolkien's own hand. His watercolors, his sketches, his drawings, his margin drawings.
Yes,
so
indeed.
So this book is a must-have on all your Christmas lists, The Art of Tolkien, The Art of Middle-earth. We're going to try to get a copy here and give you a really good deep dive preview of it, because it is amazing, and that just came out today.
It is quite remarkable. A lot of people don't even assume that those beautiful watercolors they see on those paperback editions were really Professor Tolkien's. A lot of people don't even know that he was such an accomplished, you know, watercolorist. He drew his own maps. He designed and drew the topography of his own maps and the labels.
Not just like little sketches,
but they were covered with illustrations.
Yes.
Look in any edition of The Hobbit, any edition, and there is Thror's map. And there's little dragons and little spiders drawn and little things. But if you were like me and grew up with the Ballantine books, paperback editions, every one of those, the trilogy and The Hobbit, which came boxed in a nice four-book set.
Yes.
Beautiful little paperback boxed set. All of Tolkien's best watercolors. His watercolor of Barad-dûr, the Dark Tower, well, it doesn't look quite as spiky and ornate as the one that Weta designed, but his Barad-dûr looks imposing and bleak and miserable, which is what it should look like. And in the far, far distance against this entire palette dominated by grays, and tawny browns, there's a little flicker of flame where you can see Mount Doom in the far background of this watercolor.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit of Mount Doom, a little bit of red, just a tiny touch against all the grays. It's really, really cool. That famous album of Nicole Williamson doing this recording of The Hobbit,
mm-hmm.
well, it has Tolkien's famous artwork right on the front cover. Someone was just talking about this album online the other day. And
so this is an amazing book for because
the book has been, we've been waiting for this a long time.
And
we've been waiting for this book.
I don't
book
think
for
a
very
lot
long time.
I don't think many fans really know how much artwork that they've seen of Lord of the Rings is actually penned by Tolkien himself.
Yes.
I think the assumption for readers nowadays is that writers write and artists art, and the reality is Tolkien drew those maps. He sketched the cover of The Hobbit with the sleeping dragon and Bilbo climbing up on that pile of gold. I mean, he painted the Shire, you know, and
that is my favorite image of the Shire.
Yes.
It's called, actually the name of that painting is called Hobbiton Across the Water. I think that's the official name of it. Hobbiton Across the Water, and there's the mill. If you read the stories as closely as we do, and you know that the Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings movies never had the Scouring of the Shire chapter, but just looking at the watercolor that Tolkien made, you can see all the buildings and the
mm-hmm.
mill where Sharky's men, the ruffians who came to take over the Shire, and all the fantastic moments that happen, the Battle of Bywater, as they remember calling it. Several hobbits died in defense of their homeland against Sharky and his thugs.
So Tolkien drew all this and painted watercolors and sketched in the margins into the book.
And
so this book
exactly,
includes all of that.
Yeah, and he knew exactly where he was going to stage his action.
Yes.
And that's why his illustrations are more technically accurate than anybody else's illustrations for Lord
and
of the Rings
you know what?
Of the Hobbit.
I'm just thinking maybe we should do
Seriously.
A comparison between all of Tolkien's sketches put together in one book finally, and compare that to what Ralph Bakshi did with
mm-hmm.
his animated Lord of the Rings, and compare and contrast what Tolkien envisioned in his own mind from his own hand and what Bakshi actually put on screen, and then maybe compare that to what Peter Jackson did, because as we know, there's a cascading thing of influence. You know what else
yes.
happened this
yes.
weekend?
There is.
I tell you, I can't be more proud of this guy, this hobbit, this man of men. Sean Astin completed a full 140-mile Ironman World Triathlon.
That's stunning. That's really, really amazing that he went all out
for
that.
It's one thing to attempt a full triathlon. It's another thing to finish. Greater men than him have bonked out. You know, like you just hit the wall and your body can't move.
Don't underestimate your Sam.
Greater athletes, some of the greatest athletes, I mean, world championship marathon runners, cannot complete an Ironman. An Ironman triathlon is the pinnacle of athleticism, and Sean Astin completed his
indeed
in one day. In just over 15 hours, he swam for 2.4 miles in the Pacific Ocean on the Hawaiian Islands.
So fantastic.
So he swam in the ocean for 2 miles. That is a very, very long distance. When you think about doing laps in the pool and you think about swimming across the lake, 2 miles in the ocean is very, very, very far.
Yes, it is.
And then
Absolutely.
Right after you get out of the ocean, you know, your hands and arms and legs have been kicking that whole time. You've got about 7 minutes to find your bicycle and start bike riding 112 miles up the Hawaiian mountains.
Well, it makes you stop and wonder who invented this sport. It is absolutely insane. At a certain level, you have to think this is insane.
Before the Iron Man movies,
really impressive.
Before Jon Favreau and the guys at Marvel created the Iron Man movies, Iron Man meant athleticism.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you say Iron Man anywhere, you'd see the stickers. So not only did he finish the mountainous terrain, the very rocky mountainous terrain. This isn't like rolling hills of the Shire. like volcanic mountains of Hawaii. Sean finished the bike ride and then started a full marathon, just like the Boston Marathon or the Los Angeles Marathon. We're talking 26.2 miles. He hit the road, started running. That's insane. After doing all that, the swimming and the biking, then you have to do a full marathon.
Wasn't there a live stream also going for
all day long? It was crashing. It was so popular.
That's fantastic. So, you know, if there's ever a time that you watch The Return of the King and you think to yourself, oh no, come on, he's not really going to pick Elijah Wood up. Well, Sean Astin is a strong, strong iron man. Not only can he pick up a hobbit on his shoulder, but he can pick up that hobbit and that evil ring at the same time, and he can swim, run, and bicycle 140 miles with that hobbit and with that ring.
He must have had Lembas bars all along that. Instead of Cliff bars and Power bars, he was eating Lembas the whole time. There's no way a regular human can complete. Many try. Not all of the people at the Ironman World Championship, not all of them make it to the end.
That's true.
You have to qualify for the World Championship. I mean, it is very, very hard to qualify. You have to do a full Ironman within the last 12 months and like finish, you know, top 10. I mean, say what you want about CrossFit Games. Ironman is true athleticism, and Sean Astin is an Ironman, and we hope to get him on the show soon because I want to hear all about it. I want to hear about his training. I want to hear what was going through his head.
Me too.
And so many Ringer fans were out there cheering him on. They flew to Hawaii. That was just it. I am in awe. I am in more awe of this man for completing an
Ironman.
Would you
ever yourself?
I can't. I physically can't. I did a half marathon, and then I got about 2/3 through a full 26-mile marathon, and before my body shut down. So the idea of doing 2 miles in the swim and then a bike ride, I mean, it's just I can't even imagine. And do it all in a day without rest. So big day, big day. Tolkien's got a new book out, the extended edition.
Well, that should be coming out very soon. Now, there's already an existing.
It's out today. Today's the publishing day.
Today is the publication day.
Yeah. And the extended edition is out, but there's something else really big happening here in LA. It's a very, very rare.
Very rare. We're going to get to this in just a moment. To answer the question in our live chat, and hello, everybody. Really glad to have you with us live on the hotline and on the live chat show. How many miles was it from Rivendell to Mount Doom?
I think it was like 400 miles.
It's actually right here. Let's take a look at how far we need to walk first.
If my memory recalls correctly.
All right. So it is 458 miles from Hobbiton to Rivendell.
That's close without going over.
Well, that's just from Hobbiton to Rivendell. But you want to know how far from Rivendell to Mount Doom? Okay. Well,
By way of Osgiliath?
It says the total journey from Hobbiton to Mordor to Mount Doom, 1,779 miles. Okay? But you'll just have to say it. there's a whole breakdown on this fantastic nerd fitness website, and that's where Sean, I'm sure, got a lot of his training tips from the nerdfitness.com website.
And if you tuned in last week, we profiled the Atlas of Middle Earth.
We did.
So
that was
so
fantastic. 462 miles from Rivendell through Moria to Lothlorien. Another 389 miles from Lothlorien down to Rauros Falls. And then 470 miles where Frodo and Sam separate from the Broken Fellowship, going east off to Mordor and Mount Doom.
So
you've got to take.
I'm a little slow on the take, but that's about 1,670 miles.
I'm going to have to do
1,672 miles, I think, right around there.
Very quick, 462.
So 1,600 miles is about half the size of the United States. So it's about here to Kansas.
Plus 470. 1,321 miles.
1,321 miles.
From Rivendell to Mount Doom. There you go.
So
that's a hefty jaunt, isn't it?
Yeah, that's about here through Colorado.
Wow.
I wouldn't mind
from Los Angeles to Colorado.
I wouldn't mind hiking the Rockies.
No. It's no. Colorado is 1,300 miles from LA. Will take you further than Colorado. You'll get to Oklahoma City, or maybe to St. Louis by that far.
St. Louis, you think?
I do think. Well, maybe I don't know anything about geography, but you guys are so...
How were the hobbits you still guys are so fat funny. After all that? I don't know how Gollum could keep calling them stupid fat hobbits. I mean, if you're hiking for that distance, for that amount of time, you're going to lose weight.
To answer the question on the hotline...
No wonder they got all the chicks when they got back to Hobbiton.
You're so funny.
They were ripped.
Oh, yeah, I know, of course. But then why weren't there any chicks talking to them in the Green Dragon Inn when they got back home? They were sitting there by themselves being silent, and no ladies were talking to them. But anyways, extended edition Battle of the Five Armies, a question from Iruana Undomiel. I don't know why the question is phrased this way, but should the extended edition show Thorin's funeral?
The original
we've been talking about this for a year.
Should have.
The original edition that came out a year ago or 10 months ago should have had Thorin's funeral. And many of us, including this little fan, have been really pissed off for like 10 months that there's no funeral for Thorin.
I tell you, if we get shortchanged on this funeral, throwing popcorn at the screen.
So am I.
Shortchanged on this, no way, Jose. Take your movie back, Peter Jackson, and give us the one that you're supposed to make. Don't shortchange us. I'm going to withhold judgment until next week. Seriously, we've been waiting for the... This is the movie we were meant to see.
It's true. Yes.
And...
But what can we do when we are just, you know, fans here with a rather large megaphone to talk to the online community around the world? Everybody has their own feelings about this, but everyone that watched... the cartoon of The Hobbit back in the 70s was in tears, just in tears, because Gandalf takes Bilbo into the tent where Thorin is dying, and then Bilbo and Thorin have their quiet little talk together right before he dies.
Yes.
Remember that?
Yeah.
Well, he doesn't even get a funeral in that movie, but it was close enough to saying goodbye that it felt like he was, you know, being treated properly. The character doesn't get a funeral in the films at all. It's a glaring omission in Battle of the Five Armies, and we hope that Beorn and other important persona non grata, they better show up at that funeral. Yes, they'd better.
Well,
that's just my thing.
Well, the DVDs are coming out soon enough, so you'll all be able to see it, and we recommend not pre-ordering it anywhere because there's a lot of exclusives everywhere. Amazon's got a thing, Amazon UK's got a thing, Target's going to have a thing.
Yes, yes, Target's going to have a thing.
I pray to Eru that the content on the discs are the same. Please don't shift all of the different bonus features on different discs like they've done the other two movies.
Did they?
This has been the worst. We need to make an animation of Thorin's funeral in the style of Peter Jackson. That would be great. I think Star Wars did something like that where a bunch of fans animated one of the movies or a series of the movies.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of Noelle Stevenson, I just emailed her and looks like she might be available in the next few weeks. So we're gonna try to get Noelle Stevenson, Ginger Hayes, back on the air. She's had the craziest, most insane year. I can't, you know,
her career has gone like a firecracker, right over the roofs.
I'm
right above
so
our heads.
Excited
I am
for
too.
All the opportunities. She won a bunch of awards,
really
Eisner
awesome.
Awards.
Yes.
I mean, what is the real thing? So I really would like to get her opinion, her final opinion on the Hobbit trilogy. I know she's really got a great viewpoint and important things to say. And I
she
really,
does.
I can't, I hope we can get her on the show.
Me too.
And hope we can get Sean on the show next month as well. Gosh, I have a lot of booking to do.
Yes, so, we do have a lot of booking to do.
Well, you know, we run out of time, we better jump on this conversation
before
because
we run
you're
out of time,
super excited. Look,
we have an hour. We have an hour.
I'm stopping the show on the mark because I have to get to the theater. I don't know what the traffic's like. I gotta park, you know, yes, the you whole do. Deal. Like,
yes, you do.
I'm not gonna be late for Battle of Five Armies Extended Edition. So,
no, you're not.
I over promise here you won't. In Hollywood,
allow me.
Go ahead.
There's a connection that we have not examined up close on our many, many episodes of Torn Tuesday, and perhaps it's something worth writing about, a nice feature article that I could write to support what we're talking about. But a lot of fans out there are very familiar with a little animated film that the Disney Studios put out in 1985, July 1985, to be precise. It was the very last movie to have ever been made in 70mm widescreen Super Technirama. It had previously been done on a lot of big films in the 50s and 60s, when Disney was at the height of their artistic power. Sleeping Beauty was the last movie they did in 70mm widescreen Super Technirama. A long time later, after Sleeping Beauty, they decided that they were going to go back to creating what they thought would be a very big, very important, generational, cultural statement. In their animation department, they'd been working on this film since 1971. It didn't come out till 1985 in theaters. It is the most controversial film that Disney Animation ever put out. Mm-hmm. By far, it has the most tumultuous production history, where people left, an exodus of animators left, they lost staff, a new CEO came over, kicking out Walt Disney's son-in-law, Ron Miller, who was actually married to Walt Disney's daughter. And he had a target on his back the whole time, simply because he was Walt Disney's son-in-law, mm-hmm. who had gotten the job, and many people thought he was undeserving of being the CEO. Ron Miller, who was just as much a fan of The Lord of the Rings as he was a fan of The Chronicles of Prydain. That's it. That's what we're getting at, too. After the success of Ralph Bakshi's Wizards and the huge success a couple of years earlier of Conan the Barbarian, with the advent of what was, in the 1980s, a big, big wave of major fantasy productions that came in all shapes and sizes, animated and live action, from everybody from The Neverending Story all the way down to Jim Henson's The Dark Crystal and Arnold Schwarzenegger in Conan. All these great big animated masterpieces, well, give or take a few, Disney decided to put their hat in the ring. Count, do the math. From 1971 to 1985, over 14 years of artistic development, production, and then some terrible things happened. The movie was butchered by a new corporate head of the studio who didn't know anything about handling an animation, and it lost 12 minutes of footage. We're talking about The Black Cauldron. That's right.
The Black Cauldron.
Many people loathe the film, and they think it's probably one of the worst entries in the whole canon of Disney animation. While polarized on the other side of camp,
like this guy,
there are other fans, like me, who think that The Black Cauldron is a remarkable, perhaps overly ambitious, step forward for the Disney animators that eventually became a big step backward. Too bad it didn't end up the way that it was all planned after 13 or 14 years of development and production, but all the heartache and all the insane grief, the grief that these animators and the producers and the people put up with, you won't believe the story until I tell you, and we're going to talk about that tonight on Tuesday.
And I know
Tuesday.
A little bit about the history of this movie and Disney at the time, so I'm going to be the counterpoint because...
Quite interesting.
History is written by the winners.
By the victor? Is it now? Well, let's take a look at it as
And
the...
since Disney lost on this film, the animators consider themselves the winner because they were all uprising. So I've got the trailer right here. Let's watch the trailer.
Which trailer? No, wait, hold on. There was a trailer they put out in 1985 that was really silly, but they've got a brand new one that came out, you know, for the 25th DVD, and it is really much darker and much more interesting. All right, let's watch this. This is the early trailer.
Legend has it, there was once a king so cruel and so evil that the gods feared him. Since no prison could hold him, he was trapped forever in the form of a great black cauldron.
The old king, that black-hearted devil.
Walt Disney Pictures presents The Black Cauldron. Escape into a world of darkness.
Are you coming?
Me? Go in there? Oh, no, no, no. It's a terrible place.
A world of excitement. A world of dreams.
Aaron, the greatest warrior, a true hero.
And through the magic of 70mm photography and 6-track Dolby sound, you will be transported to a fantasy event for the entire family.
Look! Look, sire! It's working!
Soon, the Black Cauldron will be mine.
In the great tradition of Disney animated classics, now comes the newest Disney spectacle of them all, The Black Cauldron.
Old school Disney lettering. So that was the trailer. But before we jump into this conversation, I just want to respond to a couple people in the chat room who are talking about the extended edition. I don't think the extended edition Battle of Fire and Memories can mess up Tauriel anymore, but I wouldn't put it past them. Please don't mess up Tauriel any more than she already was. It should have been Tauriel rescuing Legolas, not the other way around. Jan Nicholson says, Cliff and Justin, do you consider Battle of Five Armies the best Hobbit movie? I never saw an official review from you guys. Well, guess what? The One Ring never published. It's the first Middle-earth movie that the One Ring has never published an official review. That pretty much sums up what everybody at the website feels about Battle of Five Armies. We felt that it was incomplete, and it was inappropriate to write a review a year ago, and it's still inappropriate to write a review until everybody has seen this extended edition and seen what the filmmakers were trying to do, because last year was a joke. We never published an official review, and that pretty much tells you what our opinion of that movie. So
yes, indeed.
You know, so you're jumping into the Black Cauldron, and already people in the chat room are like, that character reminds me of this. That character reminds me of that from Lord of the Rings. That character reminds me of that. Well, you know what? There are certain tropes in fantasy storytelling that are just common and in use. And, you know, whether Tolkien was inspired by classic myths and expanded on some of those archetypes when he got we've delved into this conversation of Tolkien's influences, which were wide and varied, and so you know there it's easy now that everybody's seen Peter Jackson's movies and through the lens of the rose-colored lens of history to see, oh wow, of course they were channeling Tolkien. I feel that Tolkien has nothing to do with this movie, and it is a very, very, very long reach to say that Disney, the studio, and Disney, the personal lives of the animators were trying to make to channel Tolkien, since they knew they would never get the rights to a Tolkien movie, and so I'm starting from that standpoint of like.
I'm glad you feel better now. I'm glad you got that out of your system.
All right.
Okay. The point perhaps should not be conflated. I think that my partner here on the show has conflated the issue.
Not partner like that.
Perhaps rather badly. There is no confusion between Tolkien and The Lord of the Rings and Lloyd Alexander's different book series, The Chronicles of Prydain, which were written about eight or 9 years after the publication of The Lord of the Rings.
So Disney actually licensed this book. Disney has been notorious for...
Specifically, Ron Miller was a champion. He was the CEO of the company.
But they actually licensed a book.
They did. They got the license for this book.
Disney stole every story from history. If it was out of copyright, which is crazy because if you look up Disney and copyright, just Google Disney copyright, you'll spend the next 6 hours reading about how Disney... Anyways,
Marfles and our other friends who were just trying to answer your question about a proper review for Battle of the Five Armies. Sorry if you got an ad. If there's automatic ads there, that happens from time to time while you're watching the live streaming. We did not publish a review of the Battle of the Five Armies because it's not that... It wasn't that the movie was not good enough for a review. That is absolutely not what we said. It just was that the film that we saw in theaters was not complete.
It felt incomplete.
It felt really incomplete, and it was not what we believe is the final version of the film. So, we are just withholding our official reviews until we see the final version, which in my mind and in Justin's mind, and for this once we agree, Battle of the Five Armies Extended Edition will be regarded as canon. It will be regarded as the film that will get an official review, at least from this staff person on TheOneRing.net. Now, back to Chronicles of Prydain
and The Black Cauldron. There are many movies that the history of Disney animation is full of copyright-free stories that they just started animating.
Old fables from many, many, many centuries ago. Aesop's fables.
And the very few movies that Disney started to license. He started to license stories and books. Because
Like the Winnie the Pooh characters.
Like the Winnie the Pooh characters. But more famously now, Mary Poppins. It was turned into a big movie with Tom Hanks. The story of licensing Mary Poppins.
Is the story of saving Mr. Banks.
Saving Mr. Banks to bring that to the big screen. So,
that's correct.
So here we are. Disney himself had started to license, and he didn't have a good time. If you watch Saving Mr. Banks, he did not have a good time licensing that work from that author. And so Walt Disney himself was trying not to license a lot of stuff because of just the pain, the political pain involved in licensing works of authors that were still living.
Yes.
So Disney passes away. His son-in-law, there was no succession plan. Put in place at the corporate level, so his son-in-law took over, who was the head of production. It wasn't just like, hey, bring in that kid. Like, no, he was actually running a major part of the Disney empire.
Yes,
and so they upgraded him.
Yes, he was.
And then he licensed this book because he loved it. He wanted to get into fantasy.
Yes,
and
yes.
That's where we go.
And this is where the story begins, but it is certainly not where the story ends. The Black Cauldron. Although a lot, I hear Spirited Book is in the chat room already saying, oh, it was so, so bad. And a lot of other chatters are saying, what? Who's that character that sounds like Gollum? Well, that character is Gurgi, the lead. Starts with a G. Gurgi is a character from the Chronicles of Prydain.
Sounds like
Which Skirtle. Is, allow me to finish, who is analogous to Gon Buri Gon. Anybody remember the Wild Men? There, in the northern passes of the White Mountains, encountered by the men of Rohan as they muster for war, on their way to go and help Gondor during the crisis in the War of the Ring. Well, Gon Buri Gon and those wild men who are deep in the hills and the mountain passes, that Gurgi character was something that Lloyd Alexander kind of borrowed a little bit of Gollum, the way he speaks, the way his mannerisms, the way he's very obsequious and fawning all over the hero, Taran. And yet, he's a little bit like Gollum and a lot more like Gon Buri Gon, who has never appeared in any animated or live-action version of Lord of the Rings. Unfortunately, one of my favorite characters has just always been chopped out, like Tom Bombadil, always removed from those adaptations. But Black Cauldron became a testing ground for new animators, new animators like Don Bluth and other very famous names like Tim Burton, who would, after the Black Cauldron saga, they would go on to establish major careers on their own as filmmakers in various media, both live action and animation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you watch Disney's The Black Cauldron and you might say to yourself, what? I've never seen this. A lot of people in the chat room just said, oh, I've never heard of this. What is this? The reason why a lot of you have never seen it and have maybe never heard of it is because Disney, as a company, has for some weird reason buried the film for 30 years. It has never been re-released on any movie theater for 30 freaking years until now. Right now. Well, not tonight. Tonight we're going to go see Extended Edition BOTFA. But on October 15th, on Thursday, going all the way through Sunday, the 18th of October, here in Los Angeles at the El Capitan, there is a miraculous revival, a revival screening of The Black Cauldron. Like I said, the last movie in history to be presented in 70mm Super Technorama. You know, one of my friends wrote me a letter and said, when I was working on Evita on Broadway in New York City, this movie came out in Radio City Music Hall, and Radio City Music Hall, which is a massive, massive stage, had been retrofitted to support a very special movie screen, to support the Super Technorama. And The Black Cauldron looked, and still does today, it looks like nothing that has ever come out of Disney. It is what you'd call an outlier, a very strange and interesting outlier in their cuddly, fuzzy, warm little field of family animation. The reason why this movie sticks out, to many it sticks out like a sore thumb. To me, I think it's very engaging and very interesting. But it got slapped with a PG rating the first time any Disney feature animation got hit with a PG. Why? Oh, let's take a look. Melting skull faces, like the kind you see at the end of Raiders of the Lost Ark. I mean, really ghastly, melting skull faces.
It was edgy stuff.
Corpses that come to life. Undead cauldron born is what they're called.
Yeah, look at watch this scene.
This scene, hold on, what's this scene? This is interesting. You gotta see this, guys. This animation is a little bit more heavy metal than it is Disney, if you know what I'm saying. It's a little bit more Ralph Bakshi.
This is in between Oliver and Company and the Aristocats, I believe.
It is actually after the Aristocats. It's after the Fox and the Hound. It's after the first Rescuers. But it was before Oliver.
Climbing? It will only cost you your life.
Oh, the Great Mouse Detective, I think, came after
Yes, the Great Mouse Detective came up next.
Oh! Everything is ready, sire.
I mean, this straight up looks back. Such a brave man. It's not quite rotoscope, but it's almost colorly made
and a broken down
rotoscope from an actor, just like Ralph.
Perhaps it may interest you to see what fate has in store for you.
You know, everything buried in darkness except for our heroes.
Now I call on my army of the dead. The Cauldron Born.
The Horned King.
Arise, my messengers of death. Our time has arrived.
That's straight up. See, that looks rotoscoped, you know.
This clip. You're giving away way too much.
But if you
watch look at that. This is Disney? Look at the people in the chat room saying, what? And now, listen, Don Bluth worked on pre-production for many, many years, but there was a problem. Ron Miller didn't have the proper faith. Let's call it faith. His animation team sat there and they worked on shorts, they worked on animations for the theme park, but they didn't get to start actual hardcore production on The Black Cauldron for many, many years because Ron Miller was not confident that the animation department was ready. And Don Bluth and all of his team of animators, they felt 110% confident that they were ready to take on something as dark as this. So as years went by, literally months of pre-production extended into years, eventually they got up and left. And one day, Don Bluth took 13 other animators. It was a full quarter of the animation staff. Believe me, they didn't have extra buildings like they do now. They lost almost 25 or 30% of their entire animation staff That hurt the production of the Black Cauldron very badly.
And this is on the tail end of union troubles.
Yes.
Because this has happened at the Disney studios two or three times, a couple times while Disney was still alive. There's a new PBS documentary about Walt Disney that talks about his union troubles. Interesting. We're talking early 80s.
Okay, early 80s.
And the animators just, they went on strike. They wanted better facilities with air conditioning.
That also happened. They went on strike when the Black Cauldron finally did start actual production and things were really going in full force. They gave a Battlefield promotion to one of their animation directors, and he ended up becoming the full producer of the film. And he was expected to corral all these Wildcats in the animation department and pull everything together. And right when they were pulling their stuff together, then they had to march out of the building and walk out on strike. And out the door they went. It was a really complicated mess. And it gets even worse. By the time we get to the end of the story, and I tell you about all the voice actors and the talent involved in the Black Cauldron, you will see more Lord of the Rings connections than you've ever seen before.
You know what?
Trust, when we get there, we're going to get
ahead.
There.
No, we'll get there right now. Show me something.
All right, let me tell
you.
I
don't believe you.
You don't believe me?
I don't believe you.
You're going to have to believe me.
Nothing about Lord of the Rings influenced this movie directly. So go ahead.
Okay. The wonderful artist Mike Ploog, P-L-O-O-G, look him up. Mike Ploog is really, really famous.
This is a wonderful piece that he did for the movie.
No, he didn't do this piece, but it is a wonderful piece.
It's tagged Ploog.
Really? Well, Mike Ploog did this one. He did this piece right here, where you can see the Horned King in the background, and there, somewhere in the middle, there's Taran, and there's Henwen, the oracular pig. Our hero, Taran, is a very quiet little lad who thinks that he's ready to go out into the world, but he's not quite ready. He is given by a mystical mentor, he's given the task of taking care of a very valuable pig so that an all-powerful evil relic cannot be claimed by the evil Horned King. And he is sent, unwillingly or no, he is sent out on a journey to protect or find this evil relic before the evil villain gets it. Little shadows of the storyline of Frodo and the Ring, but our voice actor for the Horned King. No, this was a pastel done by the really, really wonderful artist. Let me check my head at the door. His name was
Mel King.
Mel Shaw was able to recruit animators in 1971.
Mm-hmm.
Brand new graduates that were just coming out of Cal Arts. They were looking at this beautiful full-color flyer. What did Disney do in 1971 to get more animators to come and work for them at the studio? Well, they used artwork from the Black Cauldron, because that was going to be their biggest and most ambitious project. It was going to be their Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. It was going to be so ambitious and so big, it was done in a big, special Super Technorama format. They had developed three-dimensional holograms. They had a hologram technology that was designed and developed by wonderful animators working with the Imagineering team, and they did tests of that hologram. At the end of the film, that little clip that he was showing you briefly, it is so startling and so interesting, but they were going to freak out audiences nationwide by having the first ever holograms, laser projections coming out of the screen, so that the audience would feel that the skeletons, the undead, were coming right over their heads. This is another Mel Shaw image. This image predates the final production by 13 or 14 years.
Mm-hmm.
And
you just
really
said they
beautiful.
Used this in the early 70s to recruit
To recruit students and art students to come and join the Disney studio. Now, Taran may have some analogies to Frodo, and his wise... He is a young, inexperienced person sent in charge of an evil relic to try to keep that evil relic from falling into the hands of the villain.
Indiana Jones.
So are many other fantasy tropes, like you fairly said a little while ago. But I'm not talking about direct analogies to Tolkien. I'm talking about the road not taken. If Tolkien had been more agreeable during his lifetime, then Disney would have loved to have done The Lord of the Rings, and their efforts at making The Lord of the Rings probably would have ended up as botched and weird and complicated as the Black Cauldron ended up being.
I don't agree.
But you may not. But the Black Cauldron and the Chronicles of Prydain, specifically, are the also-ran. Since Disney could not get Tolkien, they got Lloyd Alexander, who had a 5-book series. So, the producer, Joe Hale, who was promoted on the battlefield during all the difficulties, he took book 1 and book 2 of the 5-book series, and he super condensed them. He got rid of the actual villain, who was Lord Aron, and instead he used a minor character, the Horned King, and bumped him up to be the boss bad guy of the whole Black Cauldron. Kind of like Azog. So, the voice of the Horned King is so brilliantly supplied by none other than John Hurt. John Hurt had been working with Bakshi as the voice of Aragorn in the animated Lord of the Rings. Anyways,
work if you can get it.
Back to Mike Ploog. Mike Ploog, the artist, did Wizards for Bakshi. He did Lord of the Rings in 1978 for Bakshi. And then what did he do next? He did great character designs for the Black Cauldron. They were so detailed and so popular that the animators started taking his stuff and posting them all around the office. And then they put together some of Mike Ploog's best drawings and made a little full-color booklet. And that's why when people look at the Black Cauldron now, 30 years later, they say, whoa, that looks a little bit like leftover characters from a Bakshi film. And that would be why. Because they were using Mike Ploog's design.
This is tagged Mike.
This is tagged Mike?
Mm-hmm.
Really? Well, this artist is unknown who's doing this. The location we're looking at within the film is Morva. That's where the three witches are hiding in secret, the location of the cauldron. And this was rendered in full color, and it's really fascinating. You know that Black Cauldron thing that was floating around in that sequence? And you said that looks like it was rotoscoped? It wasn't. It was all hand-drawn by Patty Peraza. Patty Peraza might be an unknown name to you, but she is famous because she was the very first female effects animator ever to work at the Walt Disney Animation House. And I mean effects animator. She hand-drew that cauldron that you saw, and in the swirling mists that you see in the trailer, she drew the color tones, the smoke, the swirling mists, the water, the sparkling effects. She was the effects animator for everything that was done, and she was the very first groundbreaking woman artist to be an effects animator working at the Mouse House. And the reason why? Because Ron Miller saw her work. He was so amazed by what she was doing. He's like, is she an animator? And the guy next to him said, no, she's not an animator. She's just working in colors and effects. And he's like, bring her in. She's an animator now. So she got the job. Do you know what she did on her days off? On weekends and on the days off, and I talked to her husband personally, I found this out, to prevent the production costs from going any further, she would take her work home over the weekend and overnight, and she would painstakingly hand-draw every cell of that damn cauldron to make it look more realistic. But before I go on...
And she wasn't the first girl. She was the first woman to be the lead effects
animator.
Supervisor. But,
she was not the first female animator. That was someone else.
Disney has a history of supporting women in the workplace. I mean, women were working on Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, but
only in the ink and paint department. They were not allowed to animate. Right. You remember that story. It took quite a long time for women to be allowed to go into the exclusive boys' club, where all the animators were by themselves, separate from the ink and paint department, where the women worked.
It only took 10 years, but...
It took a lot longer than 10 years.
Famously, Mary Blair was put in charge of It's a Small World, and she was doing some stuff with Alice in Wonderland. So, you know...
Yes.
Mary Blair, and there's several other people at the Disney studio that got the chance. But, you know, I don't think this particular movie is one to highlight because of its progressive hiring practices.
I just thought it was very interesting to mention because of the details that I learned. I mean, the very first female was Retta Scott. Retta Scott was the first woman to leave the ink and paint room and be allowed to go in with the animators and work with the animators on features and on short films. And so that's a great title, and she broke that glass ceiling before anybody else did. And... you know, less than 2 weeks after Patty Peraza's promotion, other women were promoted and were able to go, you know, and work. Let's continue this conversation because...
Please do. Get to the point.
What do you mean? I've already gotten to the point several times.
I still haven't seen any Lord of the Rings connection, but continue.
The Lord of the Rings connection is something I'll explain for a second or third time, okay? In the 1980s, everybody was making money with big fantasy films. Everybody, except Disney. Disney could not get the rights to Tolkien's work because
They weren't doing anything fantasy.
Tolkien hated the Disney aesthetic, and he greatly disapproved of their representation
of
European fables.
We've talked about this before. If you go back to the notes, you will see... in the original notes, you'll know that Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs came out the same year, the same holiday season as Tolkien's Hobbit. So in the consumer marketplace, Tolkien was competing against Walt Disney when it came to fantasy storytelling with dwarves. The Hobbit and Snow White came out the same exact time, and Tolkien hated this form of artistic endeavor. He disliked and he felt like he considered Disney what a lot of people consider YouTubers now. Like, it's a lesser form of art, and he didn't understand why Disney was getting Oscars and he was getting worldwide praise in every language, saying a master of fantasy storytelling. Mm-hmm. And Disney became Disney, and instead Tolkien had to keep his day job as a professor. So it wasn't that he didn't like the Disney aesthetic. Tolkien was in competition for consumer dollars in the fantasy space. He just happened to come out with his dwarf story the same year that Disney came out with his.
Well, that was part of it.
And that began a lifelong professional competition that Tolkien never got over. So when it comes to people saying he just hated the Disney aesthetic, no, this was a personal issue. And I have no doubt at this later on, after Tolkien died, after Disney died, I have no doubt that if Disney had made a conscious effort, they could have done well for Tolkien's stories. But this was a personal grudge that Tolkien had against Disney.
Indeed it was. That's quite fair to say. Now, the idea of getting into another phase of changing the animation department is where Ron Miller was at. Ron Miller didn't want to just make another Fox and the Hound. The quality of Disney animation since he died in 1965... Right before The Jungle Book was released, when Disney died, the quality of their animation started to change. There was not a leader at the helm, and certainly by the time you look at the cheap xerography that's going on in The Rescuers and in The Fox and the Hound,
and Robin Hood
recycled large chunks of animation frame by frame from The Jungle Book.
And the Aristocats.
Frame by frame. They just stole the animation and reused it. Now, The Black Cauldron, the reason why it was in development and in production for 14 years, there's a reason why. There's a reason why they wanted to develop holograms to have the undead cauldron born. There was a reason why they were going for PG-13. Somebody made an argument with me, or rather a discussion online not too long ago, and said, The Black Cauldron was intended for children, and I don't think that is correct at all.
That's wrong.
They wanted the Black Cauldron to go to a PG-13 rating.
They wanted it
was
edgy.
It was going to go so dark. It was going to go as edgy and as dark as what they thought Conan the Barbarian. They thought that the marketplace in the 80s was a place where that kind of representation of a real, visceral evil, as beautifully supplied by John Hurt, as the voice of the Horned King.
They also wanted to be the first animated feature to get the new PG-13 rating.
Yes.
That was a brand new thing in the 80s.
Yes, it was. Yes, it was.
So there was like, all right, who's going to dominate the space? Because Don Bluth had already decamped, and he was creating a dark fantasy like The Secret of NIMH. And he was working on... If you watch the first like 20 minutes of All Dogs Go to Heaven, that is hard.
It's hardcore.
It's hardcore. Like, he goes to hell. You see
Satans
and devils drinking prostitution. Like, all dogs go to heaven. Yeah,
well, you see that in The Wind and the Willows.
I can't believe my parents ever let me watch that.
Mr. Toad in The Wind and the Willows gets a quick encounter with hell at the end of that story, but it ends up being a little bit wink-wink and a little comedic, but Taran, the hero, bleeds. The first ever Disney character in a feature film to bleed. And then they had scenes that were cut from The Black Cauldron at the very last minute, and this is going to... Oh, did we lose the entire show?
No, we're still on?
All right, listen, guys. Yes, Eroana Undomiel, you might be right. Tolkien would be crying in anger and spinning over in his grave if Disney ever took on a Lord of the Rings version.
If Walt Disney had done, but they both died within a few years of each other.
They did.
This was a personal issue with Tolkien, not an aesthetic issue with the overall thing. Because look, after Walt Disney died, Tolkien ended up selling the animation rights. You know, he ended up selling the movie rights.
He
came around to the idea that films are a new way of storytelling, and they're just as valid as books.
The biggest part of this interesting story was when Ron Miller was suddenly ousted as the CEO, the top brass of the Disney company, and then there was corporate upheaval. Over from Paramount Studios, who did they bring over?
Michael Eisner and Jeffrey Katzenberg.
A bunch of non-Disney people, and they get together and they have a big staff meeting.
Who coincidentally both ran ABC Network.
Which
Disney would later go on and buy.
Yes, they did. Coincidentally, yes. Now, here's the funny thing. When they had their first staff meeting, when Michael Eisner and Jeffrey Katzenberg came on board, they got all the people together and they said, hey, guys, we're going to take over the animation department now. And somebody was overheard leaning in to the other executive and said, they draw at 24 frames per second. That's what they said. Like, these live-action people who had never touched an animated feature before, they were so inexperienced. When Jeffrey Katzenberg saw the rough cut of The Black Cauldron, he was so horrified by the undead and the representations of what you'd call necromancy. For real. Like, Tolkien uses the word necromancer, but we never see Sauron touching dead bodies in the opening monologue of The Black Cauldron. The villain, the Horned King, has a freaking monologue to a room full of corpses where he touches the corpses and he's whispering to them and cooing to them even. And he's just so creepy. It is the darkest and by far the creepiest thing ever. Katzenberg said to Joe Hale, the producer, I need coverage.
I mean, so that's a dark Disney character. You don't...
That's actually Mike Ploog's illustration from Bakshi's The Lord of the Rings. Okay. That is the Ringwraith. In fact, that might be the Witch King himself. That's a different image. Take a look at... which one is it? Nope, not that one. That's the original poster. And that is one of Mr. Shaw's wonderful, wonderful images. Take a look at... that's our good friend from Sword in the Stone.
Yeah, so Disney was experimenting with yeah.
Oh, that's that? Here, I want to show you the widescreen Black Cauldron background. There it is. This one. Sorry, we're looking at a bunch of different things. No, I guess that's not it. Well, that's all from Sword in the Stone. I guess Taran does look a little bit like that.
Between Maleficent and Mike Sword Plume's in images. The Stone, you can see that Disney was dabbling in fantasy. For many years, the dragon from Sword in the Stone, or the dragon from Maleficent, from Sleeping Beauty, was one of the scariest things Disney had ever done. They pulled no punches. She screams, "You're going to hell." You know, and like everybody dies at the end, and it's only through like some magic that everybody lives in Sleeping Beauty. Yeah. And then in Sword of the Stone, you know, that you start to see some of these lovable characters that, succeed in spite of themselves. So, but bigger picture, the trend in society, in popular culture, during the time when the Black Cauldron was being made, was that there was this huge uptick in fantasy. Just like right now,
yes,
you can. Everyone will say this is the era of superheroes. Like, there's Marvel movies every 6 months. You know, they're all making billions of dollars. Right now we're in this superhero phase, and you know we're eventually gonna get out of it. But right now we're in a superhero phase. Well, in the late 70s, early 80s, you're in this huge fantasy phase. Huge fantasy, mysticism, and magic, and everything like that. D&D was huge, and in fact, it was so huge that the news reporters and scrupulous editors, right wing editors, usually would keep publishing articles on how D&D is corrupting your kids. Dungeons and Dragons.
Oh yes,
is ruining children. It's turning them into Satanists.
That's when Tom Hanks was in Mazes and Monsters, which was a really funky, weird exploitation movie about teenagers playing pencil and paper D&D and going bad, going very, very awry.
Yeah, so that was the stereotype. D&D leads to Satanism.
Uh-huh.
And this was just popular culture. You saw stuff on the news all the time.
Yes.
And so this was the world that Disney was entering. They had made a bunch of animated films that weren't super big hits, and so they were like, all right, let's pick up a trend. What's the trend here?
Mm-hmm.
The trend is fantasy, dark storytelling, D&D, live action movies are made about D&D. All these animated features from mm-hmm. their new competitors like Don Bluth, Ralph Bakshi, you know, the Lord of the Rings got a movie, The Hobbit got a movie, The Return of the King got a movie. I mean, there was just everyone. There was a lot of fantasy in the toy aisle, on the television, at the movies, and so.
Oh yes.
So Disney was like, you know what, we need a hit, and look, we're gonna show them how to do dark fantasy. Look, we are Disney. Our lunch is getting eaten by all of these startup animation houses that are coming up with these dark cartoons. He-Man, you know, like all the cartoons were dark too.
They were super dark.
On Saturday morning. So of course they go through their library. Like, all right, what have we optioned? What have we licensed? What can we do? And they plucked this, like, you know what, we did some early work on this black culture movie, let's do it. So they put it to work.
Now I'm the only person in the room probably who's going to be a staunch apologist for the Black Cauldron. I will defend it to my dying breath, like I will other underappreciated films like Spielberg and Kubrick's AI, artificial intelligence. I always defend that film mm-hmm. to a lot of people who like to bash it. People love to bash the Black Cauldron, and I'm the one person in the room who always waves the white flag saying, wait a minute, there's more going on with the Black Cauldron than you know. When Jeffrey Katzenberg sat down with the film's producers, and he was so freaked out because he thought that the Black Cauldron and its darkness and its representations of evil and undead
would be like Sword in the Stone.
Yeah, well, it's what he expected, a light and fluffy sword in the Stone.
Yeah.
You know what he got? He got a hardcore Conan the Barbarian level
flaming
of
skulls.
Gruesomeness. But you know what inspired the flaming, melting face? Spielberg's Raiders of the Lost Ark scene.
It was a trend at the time.
The score, the beautiful score by Elmer Bernstein, is similar to the score that you'll hear in Ghostbusters. There's a huge fanfare for the Horned King, and you'll actually, hear a very similar fanfare in Ghostbusters when evil is present. But the literalness of that evil being presented, and all those skulls and the necromancy, he looked at that, and Katzenberg said, I need coverage of this, because you can't show this. That's a live-action term that is only used for live-action filmmakers. When you want coverage, you are going to bring in something from camera B or camera C, and you're going to put coverage of it so that you don't have to show it because it's gruesome. And the animators looked at him, and they're like, you're nuts. We don't have coverage. We've been working on this for years and years and years. There's no such thing as that term in making an animated film. That shows you how wrong-headed he was. And then Joe Hale and the producers said, we're not going to cut this footage. So you know what Katzenberg did? He locked himself in a room for 3 or 4 days, and he cut the film himself. It's legendary. He forced 12 minutes to be cut from the Black Cauldron.
Mm-hmm.
He sent entire scenes into the trash can that represented millions of dollars and years of work.
Mm-hmm.
Conservative estimates on the price tag on Black Cauldron would say 22 to 25, but that's not really quite honest. The fact is, the Black Cauldron was, at its time, the most expensive animated film that Disney had ever attempted. 13 to 14 years in development and production, it was up to $45 million in final cost.
In reality,
including prints and advertising.
In reality, it was only in production 6 years, like a
typical 5.5 years,
like a typical animated film.
But what's most interesting is that he sent entire large sequences to be back to storyboards, to be redrawn, restoryboarded, and redone all over again. It delayed the film from Christmas 1984 to July 1985. When it did come out, the movie was received so poorly, and they didn't know how to market it. I'm telling you, watch the brand new movie trailer for The Black Cauldron, which just came out a few years ago in the old DVD, and then compare it to the one that came out 30 years ago, and you will say, holy Toledo, are you kidding me? Here's an example of how you market a film. Let's take a look. This is the way I would like to see The Black Cauldron marketed. This is a piece of fan art by, you know, some very, very clever fan who's done a whole bunch of redos on Disney classics. This image shows no little cute pigs, no little fairies, no happy people. There's no hero, no heroine, nobody except villains, evil Gwythaints, and the Horned King over it all. It's really, really strange and interesting. Let me find the other poster. Where's the American poster for the Black Cauldron? Do you have it? No, that's the Japanese one. We're going to show that.
Show the Japanese one.
No. I want to show the American one first before we transfer to the... well, it's hiding in here somewhere, boys and girls. But there is a poster here. Whoops.
You broke it.
I broke it. And let me show you guys this real quick. There's a poster from The Black Cauldron, the American release poster, and I don't know where it is, but it's in here somewhere. Is that it? Nope. Is that it? Nope. Anyways.
Well, this one's cool.
This is what I...
Look how vicious this is, the
Japanese poster.
You got the bleeding skull and the cute characters.
The point of this is to show how movies can be marketed to completely different audiences, who have different expectations of your studio and your branding, okay? This Japanese poster is all horror, emphasis on gruesome and ghastly, and it is so freaking creepy. The American poster is as tame as a bowl of sugar. It really is. There it is. In fact, what's interesting, most of this is about 45% white space. You know how children's films and family films don't get a dark background, they get white, a white background, to show that it's light and airy, and this is color coding in marketing, and so that, you know, you cognitively look at it when you walk by it in the theater, and you're like, oh, look at that, all that white space. But yeah. The Japanese poster is a little bit more honest in its representation. I give the Disney animators all the credit in the world for doing something way ahead of their time. Right now, we watch movies like Puss in Boots, where they have a marijuana joke, where there's a little catnip bag, and he says to the authorities...
That's not a dark movie.
No, but that's adult. That's where we're at with adult content
that's
in
Jeffrey
children's
Katzenberg.
Movies.
So Jeffrey Katzenberg was not scared to go there, but
at the time, 30 years ago, he was completely scared to go there. And he thought that the Black Cauldron was going to ruin everything for Disney's branding, and he cut 12 minutes from the film.
And he was right.
And it was, no, he hacked the film to bits.
At the time, he was right.
The editing is so bad that you can hear a truncated cymbal crash from Bernstein's score. There's a very abrupt interruption in the music of the film. That's how glaringly bad the cuts are in this film. Nowadays, we've got How to Train Your Dragon, we've got Paranorman, with all of its ghoulish undead. We've got so many great,
How to Train Your
wonderful...
Dragon is Katzenberg again.
We've got... Well, I'm saying...
Every animated film that you're citing is from the executive that you were...
No, it's not. No, it's not. Paranorman is not from Katzenberg's camp. No, it's not. I mean, It is not. Completely not. There are other animated things out here in the world now, and we're kind of blasé about it now. We don't mind if there's skeletons coming to life, and we don't care if there's, undead armies rising.
Yeah,
but
at the time,
it was too much.
Very controversial.
It was too much.
From a pop culture perspective, on the news every week was another set of kids playing the Ouija board and playing Dungeons & Dragons and becoming Satanists because they played Dungeons & Dragons. You know, some religious towns would ban board games.
Yeah.
They would ban things like Dragon Dice and Dungeons & Dragons because it was a tool of Satan.
Those are the towns where they banned dancing.
So,
like in Footloose, where dancing is just not allowed.
I mean, this
you know?
This really
no
happened.
Dancing,
so,
no Dungeons & Dragons.
So if you're coming into a studio, the Disney hires these new guys and said, help us. Fix this company, fix Disney. So they look at everything that's going on in Disney, and they come to this film, and they're like, wow, death and destruction and PG-13 and melting bodies and the undead, at the same time,
there's more.
There are towns that are banning D&D.
Yes.
Like, he's like, you think this will help Disney because it's making Disney modern for pop culture? It's like, no. He's actually was right on this call.
I couldn't agree. I mean, I could not ever agree with that. I could never
The way he went about it was wrong, and I agree with you there. Cutting up and changing the movie. Well, like, they should have just scrapped it. Nowadays, Pixar is famous. Pixar is famous for scrapping movies.
Really?
Late in the game.
For scrapping a film late in the game. Yeah, yeah.
Go to their last three movies, especially Inside Out. They said they had to throw the whole movie out and rewrite it from scratch, and it sent the whole movie into turnaround because they got three quarters of the way through the film, and they're like, you know what? This isn't working. So they tossed it all out. Just look up Pixar starting movies fresh again. There's tons of stories of Pixar doing the full commitment of reorganizing a movie that Katzenberg was just starting to do, but he didn't have the guts and he didn't have the resources to say, you know what, scrap this whole thing. Scrap it. He's like, you know what, let's fix it.
He was the least qualified person to make those decisions at the time.
He was the head of animation.
He wasn't. He knew nothing about animation.
He was the head of animation.
After The Black Cauldron was released, and after other things happened, Katzenberg went into a tutorial mode where he educated himself, and the animators who were still working there at the time figured out that he was trying to improve his level of knowledge.
Yes.
At the time when he went into the editing bay and locked himself in that room for 4 days and chopped up their beautiful work that had taken many, many, many years, he didn't know shit about it. Sorry to get PG on my own webcast, but I'm telling you, Katzenberg was the least qualified person to make that judgment call. Then, after it was much too late, when the film came out, it lost in the box office to the Care Bears movie, which is a piece of crap, straight-to-video junk, that is, an animated film made for barely 1/20th the cost to make, as did Black Cauldron. It's straight-to-video junk. And yet it succeeded, boffo box office, way more than The Black Cauldron. Why? Because at the time, the animators and I think Ron Miller particularly, who doesn't get the right amount of credit, they were way, way ahead of their time. Think about it. When John Borman had put out his version of Excalibur, he put out Excalibur because he could not get Lord of the Rings. So he'd made Excalibur. And it has everything that Game of Thrones has. Sexuality, blood, guts, gore, hard R, really hard R rated. My dad took me to see Excalibur when I was barely 10 years old, and it freaked me out. I'd never seen anything so visceral in my life. A few years later, maybe 6 years later, I'd go and see The Black Cauldron, and it also creeped me out, but at that time, I was of the age and of the temperament where I had the biggest appetite for dark fantasy, and that is why I have such affection for this film, because it is the most ambitious. This is where you have to give the animators at Disney credit full credit for doing something so ballsy that Disney had never bothered to do. They really wanted to go for PG-13. They almost got there, but they didn't. They were held back by production delays, held back by an animator strike, and they were severely lost
by
their limbs.
Changing of management.
By Katzenberg, a change of management.
It was such a weird confluence of things, you know? It was just bad timing.
Now look
it
at
was
it
the
this
wrong
way.
Project for the wrong studio what, at the wrong time.
Now, Peter Jackson took advantage of the fact of making his Lord of the Rings trilogy without that level of studio interference. He was half a world away. He was able to make his film without all that crazy interference from New Line Cinema. Do you think Bob Shea would have sat down and chopped 12 minutes out of Fellowship of the Ring just a couple of months before the release?
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that would have happened?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it didn't. It didn't happen.
It still happens. And sometimes
the
studio is right. You know,
Jackson.
When we had Jim Rigel here, he said that the studio executive came in on Godzilla 2 weeks before opening day of Godzilla, the new Godzilla. He's like, dude, you guys got to add Godzilla Atomic Breath. You know, he totally changed the ending.
Yes, he did. I'm glad he did. I'm so glad he did.
Right? So
yeah.
The studio is not always the bad guy. But my point is, look, at the time that the Black Cauldron was being made,
mm-hmm.
Fantasy was hot topic. You had all these different movies like Conan the Barbarian and Highlander.
Krull.
Masters of the Universe.
Masters of the Universe. He-Man and the Masters of the Universe had a villain with a skeleton face.
You even had,
right?
You even had comedies.
Yeah.
With Tom Hanks making fun fantasy. You had Dungeons and Dragons getting banned everywhere.
You had the wild success of Bakshi with Wizards and with his Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
And the Lord of the Rings phenomenon was so strong in the 70s and 80s because of the way the counterculture in America had embraced it at the time. Well, don't forget Sword and the Sorcerer. Remember that Bloodfest.
This was all edgy stuff. So
Beastmaster. With Mark Singer?
In an effort to keep people from leaving the studio, because a lot of unhappy, bored animators, when you get sick of drawing puppy dog eyes and Disney eyeballs on all the characters, they started leaving. They started doing The Secret of Nim. And An American Tale.
Oh, yeah.
Edgy films about, you know, the Jewish question and The Secret of Nim about
science
and technology.
Indeed, yes.
Like, these are edgy topics. So how does Disney keep animators engaged and active and say, don't leave, we'll let you do something cool?
Mm-hmm.
That's what Black Cauldron was.
That's what they promised the animators. You know, the darkest thing that Disney Animation had ever done, besides the sequence of Night on Bald Mountain, which is so fantastic, in Fantasia, the original Fantasia. But in Pinocchio, there's a transformation scene where the little boys are turned into donkeys, and it's horrific. It is so creepy and so weird. You wonder, how could Disney ever go into this,
Pinocchio,
like, little dark area? And that was the last time that the Disney animators had really done something quite as dark and, you know, like necromancy, like, bleh. You know, ugh. So here comes.
So they were keeping these animators around.
They wanted to keep the animators ambitiously inspired by giving them something that they thought would be a new cultural high watermark. They thought if their Black Cauldron really thought that if their Chronicles of Prydaine was going to be as dark and as big and as successful as they really could go, that they could earn the audience that was going to see heavy metal and going to see Bakshi films.
Heavy metal.
That's where Disney wanted to take it. But it didn't happen. Management changed, and it all
got
screwed up.
Management changed and got all screwed up.
So I highly, highly recommend for any of you folks, and I know a lot of you younglings out there are saying, I've never seen this. Come with us. If you're here in Los Angeles, there are 4 days, 4 nights, where you can go see the Black Cauldron
at the El Capitan,
originally presented the way it has never been seen for 30 years. In fact, it's still not out on Blu-ray. There is no such Blu-ray. It does not exist. Disney has been so embarrassed by the Black Cauldron over so many decades, they have hidden this film away seemingly forever. But now it's a miracle. It's actually going to be there in super 70 millimeter Technorama. It's going to be so worth it to see it.
Every studio's got their hidden gems that they keep buried. Warner Brothers has this movie called The Devils, if you look that up, I think it came out in the 70s and is immediately buried. And in fact, Warner Brothers like sends suits and security to any theater that threatens to screen it.
Wow.
Yeah, there's a movie called The Devils, and it's
it is
a cult classic, and that just showed last weekend here at the Egyptian Theater in Hollywood. So there's a thing happening
that was a Disney
this
film?
Month. No, it was Warner Brothers.
Oh, Warner Brothers.
So there's something really fun happening in Hollywood this month where all the theaters in Hollywood are showing these rare prints and these rare movies that the studios want to disown.
Yes.
Ken Russell did it.
Ken Russell. Oh, yeah, with Vanessa Redgrave and Oliver Reed.
It's an interesting film. There's an X-rated film. But
last Lord of the Rings connection to the Black Cauldron in the opening.
The only one?
Well, no, there's several.
Going.
Tim Burton, as you know, became a real big name in the world of show business, and we all love Tim Burton. Some of his earliest concept characters for the Black Cauldron are so weird, you should Google search them and look them up
online.
What
does that have to do with Tolkien?
I was just getting to that. The very, very famous director, John Huston, who was the father of Angelica Huston, who played Morticia Adams in a lot of other great roles. And he was the voice of Gandalf in the Rankin and Bass animated Return of the King and The Hobbit.
Yeah.
Gandalf, his voice, John Huston, his voice is the first voice you will hear in The Black Cauldron as the narrator in the opening sequence.
Okay, that's kind of cool.
It's John Huston.
So
really exciting.
Disney was making a fantasy film. They're like, you know what? Go hire a voice cast worthy of a fantasy film. So they went out and got as many people as they could from Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, they got John Huston.
That's kind
of
cool.
The wonderful John Hurt, who would be later become the Elephant Man with David Lynch directing. And everyone knows him as Ollivander, the wand maker in the Harry Potter saga. So it's really, really fascinating. I know, and I have to admit, that The Black Cauldron is a narrative mess. It is not an adaptation.
And we just explained why.
It's not an adaptation of the Chronicles of Prydain that you read. It doesn't even resemble the Chronicles of Prydain. But the books are wonderful. They're worth reading. And the movie itself is worth seeing. So that you can take a look at, you know, what almost was. That was Disney's Lord of the Rings that almost was. And it ended up being a botched version of The Black Cauldron. But still, there's a lot of animation to appreciate. Unbelievable colors. It's unbelievably dark, creepy. And you know what? My coworker, she's a 33-year-old woman. She's never, ever seen The Black Cauldron.
A lot of people haven't because it's not worth watching. So come to Hollywood.
Let me tell you this story. I'm going to finish this story.
We got to wrap it up.
We're going to wrap it up. I showed her a one-minute clip.
Thanks for joining us.
And thank you for joining us. So I showed my coworker.
We're here every Tuesday.
And when she saw this clip of
5 p.m. Pacific.
Of the Black of the Horned King talking to all these corpses.
Thewandering.net/live.
She went home at night and she said to me the next day, Clifford, I closed my eyes and I opened my eyes again because I couldn't go to sleep. All I could see was the Horned King reaching his hands across my face and all these skulls. She was terrified to go to sleep, and she only saw 1 minute and 20 seconds of the Black Cauldron, and this grown-ass woman couldn't even go to sleep
Follow
at night.
Follow him on Twitter, QuickBeam2000.
That's how creepy it is. It's amazing.
QuickBeam2000.
Thank you, everybody.
On Instagram.
For joining us.
And if you check our Twitter and Facebook and our website, we're giving away copies of Tolkien's new art book. And we have some exclusive pictures and screen grabs from the extended edition, which we hope is better than the theatrical version of Battle of Five Armies. We're off to go see that movie.
We'll
catch you next week.
I agree with you, Erwana, that The Secret of Kells is wonderful artistry. It's beautiful animation. But we're going to go now to the theaters because we've got an extended edition to go and see.
No, you stay. You keep talking.
Hey.
I'm going.
Hey, there's a lot of spoilers. There are people already talking on our message boards. So if you don't want to read the spoilers, then don't. You're going to see for yourself tonight if you're in the theaters. Or you can wait until the iTunes comes out next week. Thank you for joining us on Torn Tuesday. Good night, everybody. Sweet dreams. Bye. Ha ha ha.